When Graham Gund attended Kenyon, there were 500 students, the library was in Ransom Hall, and the one art class was taught in Pierce's Tower. But he could see and love the original design of Kenyon's campus reflecting along Middle Path. After graduating in 1963, Gund earned a Master of Architecture and a Master of Architecture and Urban Design from the Harvard University Graduate School of Design. He founded the firm that bears his name in 1971 and has won scores of awards for his buildings in Boston, Washington, D.C., Cleveland, and elsewhere. In the past 16 years, he has returned to Gambier to create a wide range of buildings that enhance the campus's original vision for a liberal arts community.
I think it's very important how schools start out with their buildings. You can almost tell when you look at the original buildings how successful the campus is going to be in the future. Because if there's a strong interest in design in the beginning, then better buildings kind of follow because you're kind of keeping something. But if you don't have that, or if you somehow lose it with a separation, then people aren't as interested. So there isn't a tradition to maintain, there isn't a sense of history and of purpose. So that's a problem for lots of campuses. I've always thought that the campus is unique. There was such vision on the way the original campus was laid out. I mean, when you think of them tromping through woods and just to get to the site, and then this grand plan, a vision for the school which stretched almost a mile in length.
In his 16 years of work in Gambier, Gund has added important capability to the academic life of Kenyon and robust activity to the Kenyon community. The dining experience in Pierce Hall is restorative and inspiring. The Kenyon Athletic Center revitalizes young and old alike. And music students now have sunlit practice rooms, and art students now have modern, flexible studio space.
I love the art department here, and this is one of the greatest art buildings I could hope for. I mean, this is nicer than a lot of grad school spaces.
It's great to see all these changes to the campus. I would like to think that with all the new buildings, that the campus, the essence of the campus has stayed the same, and that we've been respectful of the historic buildings and have carried Kenyon through to the next 100 years or more. I think we like working on campuses, particularly because each building involves planning, but that campuses generally think about a 100-year time span. So it's very different from building for a developer. So you have to build with future changes in mind.
Good evening. I'm Sean Decatur, president of Kenyon College, and welcome to the fifth installment of the Kenyon Unique Lecture Series. The Kenyon Unique Series aims to capture the stories and voices of some of our most distinguished faculty and alumni, talking about the topics that they know best as leaders in their fields. Prior lectures have been given by Professors Peter Rutkoff and Will Scott, writer-in-residence P.F. Kluge, Professor of Sociology Howard Sachs, and Professor of Psychology Sarah Mernon. Tonight, we are lucky to have acclaimed architect and Kenyon alum Graham Gund as our guest of honor, and he'll be joined in conversation by Kenyon trustee and fellow alum Matt Winkler. Matt graduated from Kenyon in 1977 with a degree in history and received an honorary degree from the college in 2000. He is also a Kenyon parent whose daughter Lydia was a member of the class of 2013. Matt began his career in journalism right here in Gambier, serving as editor-in-chief of the Kenyon Collegian, and then working for the Mount Vernon News after his graduation. During the 1980s, he reported for the Wall Street Journal in New York and London. In 1990, Michael Bloomberg approached Matt about getting into the news business. The two men started Bloomberg Business News from scratch, and today, as Bloomberg News, the company is one of the world's largest and most influential news organizations, with thousands of reporters and editors working in bureaus around the world. Matt served as the first editor-in-chief of Bloomberg News and is now its editor-in-chief emeritus. Matt also has a long history of service to Kenyon. He was a key player in the efforts to save the Kenyon Review, serving on and later chairing the board of that organization. Matt also helped provide access to Kenyon's own Bloomberg terminal, operated by LBIS and available for use by students and faculty who use financial data in their own research. Matt was the driving force behind this Kenyon Unique lecture series, so I can't think of a better person to be here tonight for the fifth event. So before I say more about Graham Gunn, class of 63, and you heard a bit about him in the film, I'd actually just like to tell a little bit of a story. In 1994, I went to South Hadley, Massachusetts to interview for what would become my first academic job in the chemistry department at Mount Holyoke College. And, you know, typical faculty interview, I was given a tour of the campus, and my guides for the tour were particularly proud of recent renovation and expansion of Williston Library, one of the central buildings in the core part of campus. The renovation included a new wing that housed the science collection, so I spent a lot of time there, and an extensive renovation and restoration of the historic original building, including a grand reading room and dramatic entrance atrium modeled on the Medici Library in Florence. The new science wing, which I, over the course of the next 13 years, would get to know very well, was modern, warm, and inviting, yet seamlessly integrated into the historic original building. You know, while I was on the tour, the other major project that folks on campus were buzzing about was the Village Commons, a mixed-use area directly across the street from the library. A fire in the late 1980s had destroyed many of the buildings housing stores and services that served both the college and the community. And in its place grew a new set of buildings, each with retail downstairs and housing above. These nooks and crannies of the Village Commons would become my regular haunts for over a dozen years. Now, fast forward almost 10 years. In the late summer of 2003, Renee, Sabine, Owen, and I took a road trip back home to Cleveland to visit family. And my in-laws insisted that we go to University Circle to visit one of the new additions to town, the Cleveland Botanical Gardens. The striking glass structure seemed to emerge spontaneously from diverse lush gardens, yet also blend into the surrounding neighborhood. Inside, the space was bright, airy, and contemporary. It quickly became and remains one of my favorite spots in my favorite city. Now, fast forward yet another 10 years. I had just begun my work as president here at Kenyon, and I quickly came to appreciate the balance on campus of traditional and contemporary, integrated throughout the campus plan with careful intent. I also learned about one of our most distinguished alumni, acclaimed architect Graham Gunn, class of 63, a psychology major, an AD member, who then went on to study at the Rhode Island School of Design and earn master's degrees in architecture and urban design from Harvard. Then go on to establish the firm Gunn Partnership and launch a career in architecture that's won him international acclaim and earned him an honorary degree from Kenyon in 1981. That summer, I had the chance to meet Graham for the first time at his office in Cambridge. I already knew we had a bit in common. In addition to our Kenyon connection, Graham is a fellow Clevelander. You know, and Clevelanders stick together in this intense way. I would also later learn he was a LeBron James fan, but what Clevelander isn't? Yet we were connected by much more. While taking a tour in his office, I saw a model of the Williston Library at Mount Holyoke and photos of the South Hadley Village Commons and the Cleveland Botanical Gardens. Graham indeed was the architectural thread through these spaces that impacted me so strongly. His skillful design had powerfully shaped my experience during my time at Mount Holyoke, helping that campus maintain its place alongside Kenyon as among the most beautiful in the country. Soon I realized that Graham's work was everywhere I'd look. The library at Ohio State, the Burton Morgan Center at Denison, even the striking and kind of strange two-sided office building for the Realtor Association national headquarters a few blocks from the hotel I was recently staying at in Washington. The powerful architecture, the most powerful architecture, like all great art, is not just the product of skill, but also inspiration and passion enriched by a personal connection, indeed a spirit of love between artist and subject. Graham's work at Kenyon conveys that spirit. Beginning with Storer Hall in 2000, the Gunn Partnership has completed projects at Kenyon, including the Science Quad, the Kenyon Athletic Center, the renovation and expansion of Pierce Hall, Horvitz Hall, the North Campus Departments, the Cox Health and Counseling Center, the Eaton Center, and of course, the building we're in right at this moment, the Gunn Gallery. We all just saw a video introduction to Graham's work on our beautiful campus, and Matt and Graham's conversation tonight will include short videos profiling several Gunn Partnership projects. So with that, I'll turn things over to Matt and Graham. Matt.
Thank you, President Decatur, for your characteristically kind and discerning thoughts, and most of all, for bringing us together for this moment, which everybody should know is live streamed and preserved forever. You, President Decatur, are the perfect introduction to the latest Kenyon Unique, which transpired almost 4.5 years ago, up in the air, during a conversation with my friend and former chairman of Kenyon's Board of Trustees, Barry Schwartz, somewhere about 39,000 feet above the Ohio cornfield, I was acknowledging the death of Franklin Miller Jr. with apologies to an 1831 Kenyon matriculate who served another president. I said to Barry, "Now he belongs to the ages." Between 1948 and 1981, Professor Miller taught physics to Kenyon students, Graham Gund included. Franklin Miller Jr. was no ordinary man, not because he lived to 100. He graduated from Swarthmore, where President Decatur would receive his BA in chemistry 57 years later. With a doctorate in physics from the University of Chicago, Professor Miller went to Rutgers University. On the Hill in Gambier, he wrote College Physics, a textbook used throughout the US in 6 editions. My boss, Michael Bloomberg, read Miller at Johns Hopkins. Professor Miller also was senior co-author of Concepts in Physics, a staple of the American high school classroom, including one in Mount Vernon. Dr. Miller was multimedia before the word existed. He used a National Science Foundation grant in 1963 to produce physics demonstration films, including The Gallop and Collapse of the Tacoma Narrows Bridge. The American Association of Physics Teachers gave him the Millikan Award for Creative Teaching of Physics. Dr. Miller played the viola with the Knox Symphony. He was president of the Knox County Mental Health Association, the United Way of Knox County, and the Kenyon Festival Theater. He helped found the Kenyon or Knox County chapter of the NAACP. He was the disc jockey for Music of the Masters on WMBO. He was a member of the Granville Monthly Meeting of the Religious Society of Friends. Now you know why he declined an invitation to work on the Manhattan Project's atomic bomb during the Second World War. In its aftermath, he was co-founder of the International Society for Social Responsibility in Science, and as its president, he met with Albert Einstein, a fellow member. Einstein wasn't the only Nobel laureate Dr. Miller counted as his friend. There were many. Professor Miller remains impossible to replicate. He passed away in 2012 without so much as a real-time or everlasting celebration of his life and work. But in this space, this very space that Graham Gund created, Professor Miller is the inspiration for the five who preceded us tonight as Kenyon Unique: Peter Rutkoff, Will Scott, Fred Kluge, Howard Sachs, and Sarah Mernon. They're on YouTube in case you missed them. And I'm sure Professor Miller is smiling on us right now with this spectacle to make Kenyon Unique unfold once again. Graham Gund should need no introduction. But like Franklin Miller Jr., who also didn't like to talk about himself, Graham Gund most certainly could use a Boswell the same way Dr. Johnson benefited from it. In 2013, the Collegian's editor-in-chief caught up with Graham at his office on the second floor of the former courthouse at Cambridge's Bullfinch Square. And this editor had the news judgment to report in the fourth paragraph of a lengthy profile that Graham Gund Architects in 1984 saved the centuries-old buildings from demolition. That event and others like it prompted Vincent Scully, the Sterling Professor Emeritus of the History of Art in Architecture at Yale, to call Graham Gunn a convinced preservationist and to compare him to Charles Bulfinch, the same who created Massachusetts State House, Faneuil Hall, and of course the US Capitol. Graham Gunn's passion for art began with classes at the Cleveland Art Museum, where he was escorted by his mother, Jessica Rosler Gunn, who died when he was 13. George Gunn, Graham's father, was president and chairman of Cleveland Trust Company, the largest bank in Ohio at the time. He thought it was important to be a banker, and he thought if you weren't in banking, you weren't in the mainstream of life, Graham Gunn told the Collegian. So we always differed on that, he said about his father, who died in 1966 when Gunn was pursuing master's degrees in architecture and urban planning from Harvard. George Gunn Hall, the brainchild of Graham Gunn, is the site of the Harvard Graduate School of Design. When he wasn't taking Professor Miller's physics class, Graham Gunn was majoring in psychology. During his senior year in 1962, Robert Frost came to Kenyon to dedicate the new Chalmers Library. While the poet was dining with Kenyon President F. Edward Lund, Graham and a classmate knocked on the door of Cromwell Cottage and asked to meet the four-time winner of the Pulitzer Prize, who subsequently spoke at the library dedication. That was a great moment, Gunn told the Collegian. He talked about the importance of humanities, the importance of going to the library and having it out with yourself, and finding out who you were and what your beliefs were. The same could be said about Graham Gunn, according to Paul Goldberger, the architecture critic who received the Pulitzer Prize in 1984 and who is a trustee of the Gunn Gallery and a chair of the Buildings and Grounds Committee of the Kenyon Board. Graham, Paul told me, understands so many of the great issues as a citizen. He is willing to engage. You know it takes a certain amount of courage to do what he did with bankers, especially in his family. And what he did with architecture takes an extraordinary amount of courage. He was pushing upstream, fighting a tide, Goldberg told me. People who know nothing about Kenyon instantly recognize Graham Gunn when they visit the National Association of Realtors in Washington, D.C., the Conservatory for the Cleveland Botanical Garden, as mentioned, the Boston Ballet headquarters, and of course, the Ohio State Library in Columbus. At Kenyon, Gunn is unique in this century as an alumnus who connects the original footprint of an American college with its future. His architecture enhances and endures because it is instantly timeless. Perhaps only James Gamble Rogers, who graduated from Yale in 1889 and is responsible for many of its Gothic Revival buildings and the university's master plan in 1924, is comparable to what Graham has achieved.
It was important that the building looked like an art building. We had some earlier plans where it looked more like a classroom building. An important part of the design was to try and get the mullions as thin as possible. So they kind of floated rather than becoming heavily outlined. I think it worked well. It took us months to figure out how to do it. It seemed in the end the best approach was to have one big space which they could use in a variety of ways. It was important to appeal to the public, to actually see something going on, see the activity and the nature of Gothic architecture. The entrances are all quite closed and it's hard to see into buildings. Since this was a more public building, it was important to have more glass in the front. So in this case, they're louvers. because a lot of things, if they're light sensitive, like drawings or things on paper, you only want about 5% of the light you would have on a normal day inside, otherwise they start to decay. So by having it change, and with the louvers, you can have a lot of natural light or you can have very little. I never would have thought that in 5 years' time, they could do as much as they've done. It's worthy of the Museum of Modern Art. I mean, it's the same level, and it's just phenomenal. And the way they engage lots of students, faculty, and the community, it's just been a great success, much more than I could have ever dreamed it would be.
So Graham, let's begin with the space you created. We just saw and heard you upstairs in the lobby on the video. Gun Gallery, just 5 years since completion, already it's celebrated as a landmark building. We know you're proud of the curatorial work of the gallery staff here, the student curators. What were you thinking when you insisted on finding the very same stones as Old Kenyon, putting them right next to where President Decatur lives? And what are you thinking now?
Well, first let me thank Sean and you, Matt, for that introduction. I feel I'm probably best off if I don't say anything, because I'm way ahead now. But it was an interesting time when this building was conceived, because we were very lucky to have Greg Spade as the provost. I don't know of any other small college that ever has had an artist and a teacher of art as their provost. And it's not surprising that shortly after that, two buildings were built, two art buildings at Kenyon. We spent a lot of time trying to figure out what the best location for the building was. We had a number of studies. It traveled all over the campus. It was down by the theater. It was over by Lentz. It was further behind Cromwell. And at one point, we looked into the idea of moving Cromwell, either backwards or forwards. And I talked to the mover that we'd hired, and I asked him if he'd ever had any problems with moving buildings. And he said, well, only once. I dropped one. And that sort of ended the whole conversation right there. But I think the reason was that this building has a public nature that other buildings on campus don't have. So that it was important that it be close to the town, so that people from outside the campus could readily find it. So I think it ended up in a perfect location. It is rather close to the library, but the plans for the new library actually call for building the same size but much more compact and efficient, so there'll be considerably more space next to it.
How important was it to get the natural light into the main gallery on the second floor without damaging the artwork? And when did you realize you needed the aluminum louvers you designed to control how much light comes through the skylight, and then you have the terracotta baguettes that around the glass lobby providing shading from the sun and an open feeling? I mean, when did all that happen? Was that an epiphany? What?
I wish. It's a little slower process, but I really dislike art museums from the kind of 70s era where they cut out all the natural light. And I think in some ways it's easier because you never have to worry about it. And it's also easier to light. And this is done, you see this a lot in Europe, where people will have lights that cover a whole wall. And it doesn't matter in museums what the show is, they don't change the lighting. But it means that it's as bright around the picture as the picture, which I think leaves a lot to be desired. Here, we wanted to have natural light, but of course from the north. And the louvers help moderate the light because some things like works on paper, you really don't want more than 5% natural light, otherwise they decay. So it was important to have the option, but it was also important to have the building express on the exterior what it was. And so by having the skylights, it's clearly a museum building. It uses natural light in a way that I think is immediately apparent. I think it's nice to have buildings that reflect their usage. That's a different kind of expression, and it should be for every building on a campus.
You love modern art, we know that. You are passionate about the importance of thoughtful public art. This must begin somewhere, but I think it begins actually where you live and where you are, in your own house, actually. I think that's a picture of where you live. Why is this passion so important to Kenyon in our lives here?
I just thought of something on the other question before. people sometimes wonder about the glassiness of the front of this building. And it was so that it'd be very inviting to people. But having that much glass on the front of a building on Middle Path seemed a little too much. So the baguettes, the terracotta bands help moderate the glassiness of it with the same color as the stone.
So I'm not going to let you escape the question about art, you and art.
Okay. I grew up being very interested in art. I think around the house, my father knew Charles Russell in his early days. And there were mostly Remingtons and Russells and that kind of painting. And I think it was not so much about the art, it was about what it evoked to him. So I think that was an early interest. But I think art is a language that documents kind of social and cultural history. It's challenging. It makes one think of what they are and how they might change it, what they wish to become. And I think it's very important to have art on campuses, because if you're exposed to it early age, then it leaves an impression on you. I think also it's very true that art, if you can grow up with it, because there's always new art coming along. But so it's different from symphonies, where if you don't grow up listening to symphonic music, you probably don't like it as you get older. But art always has something for everyone. I don't know how well it's known, but the New York Police Department teaches courses in art to some of their detectives, because it's all about learning a visual language. And if you're at a traffic corner and an incident happens, or if you're at a crime scene, you have to be able to know exactly what went on. You have to be able to talk about a whole kind of hierarchy of things that you saw. So it makes sense that police departments would do this. And it's just one example. But I think it's also, art is helpful for everyone on the campus, no matter what your major, because it teaches you to think outside the box, and even if you never have anything else to do with art, you've learned a different way of thinking, and it's sort of out-of-box thinking.
So you return to Kenyon often. You now have had enough time to see the gun gallery. It's been used. You must have some favorite exhibit that benefits best from the gallery space.
Well, the one that just finished, the Raphael Lasona hammer exhibit, I thought was particularly well done, beautifully hung. I think Natalie and her staff have done an incredible job with different shows that really challenge thinking. I think it's remarkable how she's brought different departments in to the museum and how it's helped in lots of different ways. So I think it's a great addition to the campus. When I was a student here, there was one art course that was taught in the Tower of Pierce, and we were spread out on different levels, and the teacher who came from Columbus once a week, I think, would walk up and down the spiral staircase and talk to us, and that was it.
Okay, so how do you feel about Horvitz Hall?
Horvitz Hall, the placement of it was a different kind of thing. It was a building that probably needed to be closer to the edge of campus because of the nature of what goes on there. We needed to have a big kind of terrace where students could make noise and make a mess and build things. And so I think it ended up in an interesting place and the right place because it's also an area, it makes a lot of noise, the fans on the roof. And if it were closer to the campus, you would certainly hear them. But again, the building has to have a expression that relates to art. And that's the reason for the glass. So from the outside, it feels like studios. Fortunately, the Kenyon grid just cooperates every time. I mean, it's east, west, north, south. It's perfect for lighting, perfect orientation.
Storer Hall and the Science Quad were completed about the same time, 2000, 2001, respectively. These are two very different buildings with very different challenges. Everyone here begins and ends his or her years on the steps of Ross Hall, which aside from maybe a Bob Dylan concert in the 1960s, was an inadequate place for music. How did you go about blending something completely new to a relative artifact and make it seamless? And what's the difference between Storer's 136-seat recital hall and the main hall in Ross?
Well, at the time, Ross Hall earlier, just before I was a student, had been used as a gym. And it was built as a chapel. It's had a, and when it was a gym, the locker rooms were downstairs. On the back of it, when we started, there was a kind of jerry-rigged elevator that they would struggle with to get pianos up and down to the stage. There was no place for risers for the stage to store them. So part of it was to try and make it solve all those problems. The loading, there are about seven different levels that all had to be met for just the functioning of the building. But it also had to have some kind of presence on middle path. And that's the reason for the single column. Because there are columns on the front, having one on the back that to give it a sense of importance in its location. I think the curved stair, as you come into the building, is one of my favorite spaces of the new buildings on campus. That arc that leads you up to the upper level. I think the difference, you know, Ross wasn't built as a performance hall. So the acoustics were never thought of. When I was a student, there was a white ceiling. So taking off the ceiling, I think, was a real benefit to the building. The concert hall was built as a recital hall. And the arc of the seats was very important because it was, we went back and forth on the arc and how did it relate for choral groups to stand in the audience. So the theater is used the reverse of the way you see it here. It's often with the teacher on the stage and students sitting in the seating. So the curvature had to be just right so people could see one another. In a choral practice. And of course, the acoustics were much easier. And it worked out perfectly, the sense of getting a lot of light into the building or into this particular room was also key.
Just about everywhere on college campuses in the 1960s and the 70s, we saw so many buildings that were so much concrete, they were opaque, they clashed with the prevailing aesthetic of the campus. And then there was this master plan for updating the science space here with one building. And you took us in a completely different direction. This quadrangle of buildings totaling 75,000 square feet. There was Hayes, Fishman, and Tomsich Halls. Not to mention there was another 24,000 square feet for renovations to Mather and Higley Halls. Can you give us some understanding of your vision then? How important the materials were to you? Because without emulating Howard Roark, you did clear a path to a much better space.
Well, when I started, there was a master plan that the college had that called for one large building. And in fact, if you're up thousands of feet and you look at any campus, you can tell where the science building is. It's the biggest building on campus. So this would have meant a building that stretched from Higley Hall, was part of the back of Mather, and then extended past the second Mather. And so it would have made it by far the largest building, much better, much longer than actually Pierce Hall. So I thought there had to be a way to break down the scale of it. So by using buildings to create a courtyard, which were in fact the same size as Mather Hall, and the expression of the buildings was very close to the back of Mather Hall, which is quite different from the other three sides. It's mostly glass. It has a very open feeling, a very contemporary feeling, actually. The science faculty at the time insisted that everything had to be connected. So in fact, all the buildings are connected. They're connected in the basement. You have to walk outside, but they're connected on the first floor, then the bridge, and of course the top of the bridge. So everything was connected, but the building that was there, the addition to Mather, was built out of concrete block. and there was no other structural support, so that all the floor structure, ceilings, everything was dependent upon the block, which meant you couldn't change anything around. So it had to be torn down, but it couldn't be torn down until the other building was built. So that's why you can kind of walk into it. It's more open on one side than the other side. But I think it's very important to keep a similar scale on the campus to what's been before. And I think particularly in this case, it worked well. They're connected, but they're all different. They're also, by using steel and spanning between the outside wall and the inside wall on the corridor, there is no structure throughout any of the buildings. So it's possible to change a chemistry building into a physics building, or you can go back and forth, because there's no, you can have one large space that extends the length of the building, or divide it up. And I think that's very important for the future of the school, because buildings do change, and you want them to be very flexible. And now part of the design of the library is the same way, making a very flexible space which they can change over time, which will undoubtedly happen.
We're in the knowledge century. Science looms larger than it ever has. President Decatur, a biochemist, is the first scientist to lead the college in at least 100 years. William Foster Pierce, who was the longest serving Kenyon president, was a professor of psychology in 1895, and even Eli Todd Tappan, who taught mathematics before he became Kenyon president in 1869, is the most remembered for seeing the Church of the Holy Spirit completed. So now President Decatur says having sciences housed together intentionally in a quad format has created this vibrant community ripe for collaboration. Did you anticipate this result with your design?
Well, we certainly hope for it. in all the buildings we do. I think an important part is that the relationship between the buildings along Middle Path and the amount of woods between them and nature is, I think, key to the success of the campus. The idea that these buildings, they're part of a much larger space, they create a space, but then they're also kind of standalone buildings and they're set in nature. And so keeping that, and that's been the reason to add to the rear of buildings and actually create quadrangles that are subspaces to the main quadrangle and Middle Path. I think it's really unique that Kenyon's founder had such foresight to lay out a plan that has worked through centuries. And this doesn't happen on many colleges. I mean, you can find wonderful examples of colleges that, like UVA, they have a great campus in the beginning, but of course, it's about this much of the whole campus now, and the rest of the campus is totally different and not the same plan. Kenyon's plan has a breadth that makes it, I think, unique in the country. Because it's been possible to add to it, but not change it.
You mentioned nature. You have these chromium-coated glass in the windows, which cast rainbows across the stairs. What was your inspiration for this?
We try and work some kind of art into each of the buildings. In Pierce Hall, it's the birds that I thought it was interesting, because the Pierce Hall has wonderful stained glass, but it's of a very earlier time. So the idea of taking 21st century technology, which is the frit glass, the pattern of dots, and creating something of interest using dots really appealed to me. So I think it's a 21st century look at how you do that, how you make stained glass or have glass be interesting. I particularly like the shadows of it as they go across the floor in the atrium, but also in the CAC. The idea with such a big building with so many different things going on to create a kind of center in the building that that second floor level is as you go up the stairs. I always thought of that as kind of the town center where you have the elevator, which is the town tower, and then that where the circle of lights are is the kind of focus for the whole project.
Let's turn to the Kenyon Athletic Center and just take a quick pause.
Came time to work on this, it seemed like it was the best thing just to start from scratch. So it was a unique opportunity to essentially build all the athletic facilities at one time. There was a lot of interest in a more contemporary building. So in thinking about this area, which is a kind of lowland, I had thought about an inspiration being the barn and how barns have a stretched skin of wood around the structure, and then the structure is revealed inside. We saw it as a really continuation of the educational mission and experience of being at Kenyon, that things should be transparent, that people who shouldn't be intimidated by athletics. So in some ways it's designed a little like an airport. There are two different levels, one level for the viewers to be on the second level and see each of the venues. And then on the lower level, the first floor, having all the changing rooms, having the training room, all the administration. One of the things I was very intrigued in was the idea of the space that is sort of endless. And if you get a big enough ceiling, then it's like the sky, and the repetitive nature of it creates this kind of open space. So in that sense, it's like Hagia Sophia in Istanbul, where the space is so high and so big that you forget you're in the space. It's like it becomes the whole world. I think it looks great. It's nice the way it's worked out. I think with a collection of spaces, it was important to get a kind of hierarchy of spaces and to be able to bring everyone together and make this space specific. So I had seen some lights in an airport in Germany that were actually fluorescent tubes that were strung together. And then I worked with a person who did LED lighting in Massachusetts, and we came up with this sculpture that would kind of help signify this space. The thought was about a town square where there would be a tower as you came in the door. You'd see the steps going up to a central location where people could see everything, basically.
The Kenyon Athletic Center that you created was ranked the best athletic facility in the country by the Princeton Review in 2013. But never mind that. Your analogy about the barn is intriguing because it conjures up this idea of community, especially. And I'm wondering, you know, if you anticipated the Kenyon Athletic Center becoming a space that would bring people from all over Knox County, from all over Gambier, all kinds of students who wouldn't necessarily be on the sports teams. And they're all in this space now, using it eagerly. It's been 10 years since your barn, as you refer to it, was built. What do you think now?
Well, I remember back when we looked at different options of what to do. As most of you know, there was a kind of airplane drill hall or hangar, not sure, but was there, and the track was quite unusual because it ran outside the building, and there were actually columns in the middle of the track where the track would split around the columns. But we actually tried to use Ernst. We had a bridge over the road. We looked at a number of options. I think in the end, everyone just threw up their hands and decided it was better to start from scratch rather than to try and rehabilitate things and build tunnels and kind of bridges to them. So I think it is a once-in-a-lifetime thing because so many schools have, you have to walk around venues to get to other venues, and it just keeps spreading out and in the end makes no sense. So this meant we could pull everything together. It's a very efficient building. It's the same truss throughout the building. And I like the repetitive nature of it and the fact that that it only has four corners. I mean, it's 260,000 square feet with four corners. I think that it, because it was on the lowland, I remember Greg talking about the fact that this was a spot to use more contemporary architecture, which I agreed. I guess it's contemporary, but it's also so simple that I think of when people say contemporary, they're thinking of a jog here and a jog there, and that's sticking out and cantilevering and all these different things. But this is the most simple building you could imagine. I think it has seemed to work well in terms of how the transparency thought was how people could learn watching different things. So when you went there, you'd be a part of everything that was going on. I think that's worked very well.
When I was here for the 2002 commencement, the student council president gave an entire speech devoted to inadequate student housing. And after that, there was a move to build some residences at the North End, and you had a big role to play there. What was your mission when you designed the North End residences, and what do you think they've achieved?
Well, I think student attitudes towards housing had changed. When I was a student, it was always the central corridor and the rooms off the sides. I think students are looking for more independence now. And everyone felt that it was good to have a kind of living area where the kitchen came and went back and forth a number of times because there was the fear at the time that the Pierce Hall would lose business if you had kitchens in student housing. But in the end, they decided to do it, which was a good move. And I think it offers something different for students and to have a smaller community, which I think works well for upper classmen.
So you mentioned it, Pierce Hall. Maybe we can take a look at the last video tonight.
So I thought it was particularly interesting to take a Gothic building, essentially, which in the dining hall has almost no light, very narrow windows and light only around the dais, than to do something very different. Pierce Hall, the actual dining hall, the
The walls of it are the outside walls of the building. So it was necessary to come around the outside of the building and get to the kitchen area, because the kitchen stayed the same as it had been. The kitchen has 12 different serving stations. There's a variety of food. There's a wonderful farm-to-table program at Kenyon. So we saw this as a way of adding to that. It was daunting in the sense that in finding out about the historic building, the building started to come apart shortly after it was built. Nothing could be changed about the building. So in order to come up against it, we had to make sure that whatever was against it did not put any weight on the building. So that this glass structure is actually cantilevered, so it never rests on the roof. We're very interested in trying to do a space that was different, that offered another dimension for dining. Fortunately, there's an amazing view out the window, and we took advantage of that by making the walls more glass. They're more glass than wall. We like the use of light, and particularly using light as a way to lighten up spaces, a way to draw people into spaces.
It's been 8 years. You did something, actually. You took structures joined through renovations in the 50s, the 60s. You reimagined Dempsey Hall. As you just said, there was a whole idea about light and transparency that was almost opposite to the building that it's adjacent to. What are your thoughts now about it?
Well, I remember when we started, the dishwasher had been put outside the building as part of the Dempsey addition, and because it was right on the outside, they had used fluorescent lights to mimic daylight. Of course, the fluorescent lights stayed on at night. So you had these two windows that were brightly lit up with banks of fluorescence. And it just didn't make a lot of sense. So we really, this was a case of starting from scratch. We were kind of turning everything upside down, because as a student, of course, the waiters came from the kitchen. The students never went into the kitchen. And the students came from the other end. But because the walls of the hall are the outside walls of the building, they had to get students back to the kitchen without going through the main Pierce Hall. But also, there had to be enough light to make it seem inside Pierce Hall as if you had complete daylight on either side. And I think that's really worked out well. We tried to make the new dining hall as different from the old one as possible. In other words, have lots of windows, lots of light, purposely have different kinds of seating. So the tables, a lot of them are round. I insisted they have arms, and they sort of do. They're small ones, but again, to make it a different experience than the other dining hall. I noticed that the condiments still creep out. And they have a little table. Hard to understand, but into the dining spaces. But I think it's worked out very well. I like the fact that Kenyon students like to spend time there and sit and talk after meals. I don't like the dining as you walk in now in the atrium. I think it makes it kind of like a Ohio State cafeteria or something. I think it was nice to have a different kind of mood.
I'm taking a note of that, by the way.
If students just share tables, I don't think it's not a problem having enough space.
Professor Scully of Yale early on, said you're a convinced preservationist. You know, as a student, you walked middle path every day. Now it's new, brand new. It's accessible to so many more people without losing its original look. Does the 21st century middle path measure up to your standard? And perhaps, maybe you can tell us how middle path fits into what is now the restoration and enhancement of downtown Gambier that you're bringing about.
I think it's a remarkable plan, the middle path. I think it's a great improvement, what's happened. Not just the path surface, but the lighting. I think the issues that I've been concerned with are what's around it. I think what's always been traditionally was a very important point about middle path going through town was that you had a distinctly different scale in town. You had a smaller scale, generally, except for the post office and a few buildings, you have totally different materials than you have on the campus. So that it kind of makes it special. And then when Far Hall came along, it seemed to change all that. Here's a building that would be a big building on anywhere on the campus that's right in the town. And according to my source, Tom Stamp, there were five buildings on the site of the bookstore, Far Hall. So is moved to put them back to get a little more scale to the campus, to have shops, have students living over some of the shops, and to fill out what used to be behind Far Hall is basically a parking lot with the Gambier Grill, to make it a little more compatible with the whole town in terms of scale.
Graham, all of what you've been talking about tonight is part of a master plan. In that plan is this new library that would be much less costly to operate. My fellow trustee, Paul Goldberger, who knows something about these buildings, as an architecture critic, and not least a parent of a Kenyon alumnus, he told me recently, for a college that built its reputation, and I'm quoting, around the written word, Kenyon should have a library of distinction. So much else on the Kenyon campus has improved because of Graham. Why shouldn't the library? So why is your plan for the library central to the future of Kenyon, and what does it suggest about the master plan going forward?
Well, in terms of planning, if we go back to the last one, on the southern part of campus, all the paths line up between buildings so that you can go from Ross Hall to Pierce Hall and go from Ascension to Matthew, Hannah, Leonard, and then it stops. So we're part of what we're doing is trying to, again, line up buildings. So the library would be lined up with Ransom. And you can see in the drawing, if you look at around the library, you see the edge of what is now the library. So it's a much bigger footprint. This will be the same size, but it'll have a more compact plan. It'll have a large interior space, which will be, I think, a remarkable addition to the campus. But also it, here you can see the space inside. I think a lot of, right now in the library, it's very easy to lose your orientation. It's kind of sprawling. And so this, by bringing a lot of light into the center, that means that there's light all around the building from the center as well as from the exterior of the building. So it'll really be a light building, and this is, libraries are changing. I think that when we first started the library, I talked to Sean about it, and he said, Well, I'd really like all the books in the basement. And then the library should be for programs and student-related learning activities. And that's what we've done. We've kept almost the same number of books, but they're in compact shelving, and they're mostly all below grade. And there is some light that comes in below grade. But generally, it's all about different ways of learning. And part of the strategic plan, the 2020 plan, for preparing students for future life and future careers. So the space is, as I mentioned, very flexible, but it'll be used for a variety of different activities, writing center, registration, career advice, a number of new initiatives, and I think a number of new that will come along in the future.
And the master plan goes on?
Goes on, yes.
Why is a master plan so important to making the college vibrant and relevant?
I think we can think of lots of campuses where they don't have a master plan, and each new administration idea that comes along, and so they'll do something, and then they have to deal with that. I've always liked planning, and it's very important on a campus to plan for the future. And this courtyard around towards the rear of the library, which you saw in the plan, we're adding a great deal of green space, but also a place for future buildings. So there can be a kind of organized way to approach it. I think Kenyon has made some mistakes in the past, that they built buildings which they shouldn't have built in odd places, and sometimes not thinking about a building that'll last 100 years, but thinking about just what should be done right away. So I think if you follow a plan, you never make mistakes.
So you are a proud parent, and I have to ask this question. It's a very difficult question.
Right.
Which of the buildings is your favorite?
Well, I meant they're all my favorites. I mentioned the one in the Storer Hall. I think that's quite a unique space. The idea of an ascending space, which is also curved, and, light from either side. But I like them all. I think they've been good additions to the campus. I think for it started when I was a student. In addition to the science building, it was just a terrible addition. And once you start doing that, then the next person does something like it. So you have to kind of not let that kind of thing happen. I think, and we haven't seen the last of it. I think the new apartments have a lot of environmental issues and things, and so you know, it doesn't make sense to build things and then tear them down, or build them, and then when you build more, you add to it in a positive way.
I wasn't going to do this, but you've been so kind already. I can't resist. Maybe you can take a question or two from the gathering here.
Sure.
Yes, in the back. I saw you first.
Me?
Yes, please.
I think one could argue that part of the beauty of Kenyon is not just in the individual buildings, but in the architectural diversity. Are you at all worried about replacing a building like FAR, which might not be the most beautiful on campus, but add something new with the most, a bunch of like homogeneous NCA type architecture?
No. I have no qualms. I think that a lot of buildings, not just the materials, it's the scale, and that unless you have appropriate changes of scale, that everything is ruined. So I think that the town was conceived originally as a certain way, and I think it's important to try and reinforce that. Because you don't want to lose the distinction between town and the campus. It should be a separate area and should remain that way. So I think there, you know, not every building is meant to be out front as a dramatic building. I mean, there are a lot of buildings that are kind of background buildings that you need just to make a statement. So I don't have any problem with it.
We're already 15 minutes over, so okay. I think we're going to have to take it upstairs. Graham Gund, okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
For Kenyon Unique.
Thank you to Graham and to Matt, and to those of you who are live and in person and not streaming, the conversation can continue upstairs in the Fishman Lobby where there's a reception. So thank you.